this allows precision medicine, and cancer in general and uveal melanoma in particular. As we've heard, the main problem with uveal melanoma is metastasis. Despite excellent local tumor control, about 50% of patients will develop metastatic disease if they live long enough, and this is highly resistant to standard chemotherapy. We now have excellent risk stratification for these patients using gene expression profiling. We can divide patients into class 1A, who have very low risk of metastasis, class 1B with an intermediate risk, and class 2 with a high risk of metastasis. And these are the ones associated with BAP1 mutations, about 30 and 40% of patients. We can use this information now in routine patient care for the stratification of systemic surveillance, with the 1A is getting low surveillance and the class 2 is getting high intensive surveillance for the early detection of metastatic disease. But we really like to take these high-risk patients and treat them preventatively, not waiting for them to develop metastatic disease. So we need to know more about the molecular landscape of these tumors in order to target the tumors molecularly. Each one of these classes that I mentioned is associated with a specific gene mutation. The 1A is associated with EIF1AX, the class 1B is with SF3B1, and importantly, as I mentioned before, the class 2 tumors are associated with BAP1 mutations, as we first described in 2010, and has been validated by many other groups. So I'm going to focus the rest of my talk on BAP1. This is where most of the patients are dying, the ones that get BAP1 mutations. What is BAP1? Well, it is a complex gene that does many things. It's located on chromosome 3, and this accounts for the long-known association of monosomy 3 with poor outcome in uveal melanoma. But what does BAP1 actually do? We took a novel approach to understand this because we think it's too complex to really study in vitro in a biochemical way. We used an in vivo model, but this was based on the understanding that if you look at the class 1 tumors versus class 2 tumors, they really differ in their level of differentiation. So we thought that BAP1 probably is doing something in development and differentiation. So we used a Xenopus vertebrate development model. This was recently published in Science Advances. And we found that if you don't have BAP1 during development, you don't get an eye. You need BAP1 to actually get an eye. And number two, you need it for normal melanocyte differentiation. And the molecular underpinnings of this very closely parallel what we see in uveal melanoma. Without BAP1, we don't maintain melanocytic differentiation. But further, we can use this model to screen for therapeutic compounds. As we can see on the right, we've used an HDAC inhibitor specific for HDAC4 that completely reverses this developmental phenotype in Xenopus. And when we go to an in vivo model, a mouse model, using human uveal melanoma cells, we completely block the growth of uveal melanoma cells using an HDAC4 inhibitor. So now we can go back to this model and propose that these high-risk class 2 patients can be treated in the adjuvant setting with an HDAC4 directed therapy, which would be an oral, well-tolerated agent that we're looking into now for clinical trials. So in summary, precision medicine uveal melanoma really requires an understanding of the mutations that drive the cancer. We just talked about BAP1 and HDAC4 inhibition in particular, and epigenetic modulators in general. There are other mutations that can be targeted, the GNAQ family mutations and the SF3B1 mutations, perhaps with immunotherapy. And in summary, I just want to acknowledge the collaborative ocular oncology group across the country and Canada that are participating in prospective studies that have validated the gene expression profile and are validating future